The recipe to any great adventure includes being bold, brave, and challenging oneself. In this episode of Stitch, we follow people on their journey gaining wisdom, skills, and helping to make the world a better place. Thank you for joining us. I'm Stephen Graves. We're starting off with young adults embarking on exciting adventures all on their own. WYFF reporter Michael Cogdill introduces us to a young South Carolina man who skipped his graduation to fly across the country.
Congratulations, class of 2021.
Didn't really do much with high school.
Doing so, you made a difference.
I was always thinking about flying. I had to go to high school, get through it, then I could go fly airplanes.
J.L. Mann High, class of 2021, and one grad made sure to miss it.
I dream about flying every day.
Ben Templeton had a date, dressed in yellow. She's a lot older than he is.
This is a 1946 J3 Cub. It's made by Piper Aircraft in Lock Haven, Pennsylvania.
At Triple Tree Aviation, way out in the country. On graduation day itself, Ben skipped out to take a spin.
It's just a backwoods, bare bones flying airplane.
All by himself.
A compass, that's the only thing you have for navigation.
To 48 states.
You look out the window and you can find where you're going.
You
get lost sometimes.
Well, I'll just join up on you if that's cool.
It's an app called 4Flight. It shows you all the passes and valleys and roads to follow and common routes through the mountains. 2 months, 160 stops, almost 200 hours of flying.
Yes, he's young, 18 years old, in a tailwheel airplane covered in fabric with just 90 horsepower. Ben plotted the trip to fly her along roads in case of engine failure.
I'm not too nervous. I've grown up flying.
Oh, but this does take some nerve, especially if you're Ben's mom. Christine Templeton watched her little boy grow a passion for those model planes at Triple Tree, watched him grow into a pilot who first soloed at 7 in the morning before school.
It's just making me nervous.
Don't be nervous.
It's funny, I'm more worried about where you're going to sleep. What, you know, what's going to happen?
Christine, he's going to be
fine. I know. Can I have a hug really quick, Ben?
The day he left, some boyhood innocence left the ground with him. Traded for a low-altitude acquaintance with America. These are Ben's graduation photographs. And so much more.
And he is not the only teen to take a solo trip. WCVB reporter David Bienick meets a teen who is one of the youngest to ever sail solo across the Atlantic.
Cal Courier grew up in a sailing family, but he himself didn't know how to tie a knot or hoist a sail until a few months ago.
It was Thanksgiving break and I had said, I don't know what I want to do for this summer. I'm getting older. I don't just want to veg around anymore.
So the 16-year-old started taking sailing lessons and fixing up an old sailboat.
We had to peel up Gorilla tape that was here with paint on it.
Cal set sail from Marion, rounded Cape Cod, then headed east across 3,000 miles of open ocean.
Just north of me, there was a storm.
A nearby storm kicked up rough seas. Cal fought sleep deprivation, but he says the biggest challenge was being by himself with only sporadic satellite connections to his family and no phone or internet.
So this was just a great chance for me to read, get back in touch with reading. And get back in touch with just sitting there and pondering the questions of life. I didn't actually answer any, but I read some Plato.
Where's Letters of a Stoic? Here, Letters of a Stoic by Seneca.
Greek philosophy helped pass the time alone at sea. His parents waited back home in Duxbury.
We were looking at the tracker probably 20 times a day.
Then, after 4 weeks, with the sun rising over Portugal, Cal pulled into port, fell into the arms of his family, and realize something about himself.
I don't like being on my own. I'm a people person.
Cal's not sure if he'll cross any more oceans. For now, his next big adventure will be junior year of high school.
Now that's truly a fearless accomplishment. Up next, WLKY reporter Marvis Herring meets a man who's taking a pit stop in Kentucky to master a new talent. It's all part of a 65-city tour to learn a new skill special to each city.
It is no easy task, shaving these wooden cylinders into the famous Louisville Slugger bats, but Daniel Siddiqui took his best crack at it.
I'll let him do one and I'll do one.
Louisville is the 13th stop on a 65-city tour, and he's completed cross-country trips three times already.
Years ago, I did 50 different jobs in 50 states, and I worked on a horse farm here in Kentucky. I started in a bubble myself in California. I was born and raised there. I didn't know anything about Kentucky or Michigan or Ohio. So when I went to these places, I was just so inspired by the way people live and what their passions are, their different lifestyles.
This latest trip is called a Piece of Your City Tour, where Siddiqui creates something special in the city while visiting for less than 48 hours.
That's a mistake right there. That's a flat top.
That's gonna be a remake.
There were a few snags along the way, but it's not all about being perfect.
You see the pride in what people do, and that's why I do want to tackle things that are meaningful to the location that I'm at.
Siddiqui began this tour crafting beer in Portland and even getting a graffiti lesson in Brooklyn, New York.
It's constantly learning and challenging yourself, and that's why it's important to get out of your bubble.
And bat making may not be his next full-time career, but Siddiqui says he's learned a lot about the process, and with every stop, he's becoming a better man.
The reason I'm so open-minded is because I'm open to going learning about people.
After the break, we bring you people who have embarked on adventures to do good. Welcome back. We're now bringing you stories of people traveling across the country to spread some good. In California, KCRA reporter Aaron Heft caught up with a man who's hiked across America all to honor his parents.
I can be rather flippant about how many miles because it feels like I've been doing it all my life now.
In a trek of a lifetime, 30-year-old Clay Chapman is about to finish a goal many dream of, but never have the courage to embark.
Don't worry, this beard is coming off so soon.
That beard, nearly a year in the making. He's been hiking every day on the American Discovery Trail, stretching over 4,800 miles all the way from Delaware to Point Reyes National Seashore north of San Francisco. This is his final stretch.
But I thought, if I'm gonna be doing something as grand as that, I wanna be able to do a little good with it.
That good a little closer to his heart with each step.
It really hits home for me because I lost both of my parents to cancer. My mother passed away from breast cancer 10 years ago. And so this hike is very much a way to honor her.
Working with Hope Scarves, a nonprofit for metastatic breast cancer research, he says the community built along his journey cross country has been life-changing.
You can form connections, these deep relationships with people you've never met, and it's soothing in a way.
Finding a sense of closure while devoting time to heal from the loss of his parents.
It just kind of warms your soul along the way. And you get to remember them with certain things that just pop out of nowhere. And it's a little bittersweet at sometimes. It's these little beacons of hope that are out there in the distance, and it really kind of helps let you know that the world's not as dark as it often seems.
Truly a moving act. Well, staying in California, KCRA reporter Melanie Wingo introduces us to a woman biking across the country after overcoming great odds.
The mountain roads around Donner Lake are home to Whitney Hardy. twists and turns, still lined with spring snow, are her go-to cycling spots. The sloping downgrades, challenging inclines of Donner Pass Road, now training ground for the ride of her life.
Thank you. It's like, it's challenging, and I'm somebody who's super motivated and inspired by, like, I dare you.
Daring, bold, brave, adjectives don't scratch the surface of what the Truckee woman's about to take on. Now Whitney's set to embark on a 4,300-mile trek from the Oregon coast to Boston, an impressive distance for any human to cycle.
We're going to be sitting on this for 8 to 10 hours a day.
A nearly unfathomable feat when you factor in Whitney's journey to the starting line.
When the car hit me, my head hit the ground so hard that it was just like, boom.
Out for a run one evening in 2014 while living and working in Boston, a car crashed into Whitney.
My injury was extremely traumatic.
Life-threatening, according to the doctors, giving her a slim chance at survival.
I don't remember it happening. I don't remember waking up in the hospital. I don't remember the first time that I remember after the injury.
In the months following the crash, there would be a series of surgeries, recovery, and physical rehabilitation for the former college athlete. Her struggle for survival, hard fought.
I don't go backwards. Like, I don't think of, like, I wish that never happened, because it's not gonna change anything.
But the lasting effects of the traumatic brain injury she suffered remain to this day. Whitney says tackling day-to-day tasks in an organized way and difficulty with short-term memory are long-term challenges she manages daily.
Remember that you're gonna forget this. Write it down or put it somewhere in your physical bank, not your memory bank, because that doesn't happen anymore.
Making her planned journey across the country all the more meaningful.
So what I'm focused on right now is biking, like getting ready for this trip.
Ready to see new sights, test her physical limits.
It's a thing that I'm gonna look back on and a really long time be like, yeah, I did that.
And connect with people just like her along the way.
I'm kind of hopeful that I'll meet others who have been through traumatic brain injury, and so kind of create a community of those who have suffered similarly to what I have.
3 months later, Whitney crossed the finish line in Boston. What a prime example of true strength. Well, staying in Boston, WCVB's Erica Tarantell shows us a mother traveling across the country to spread kindness in honor of her late son.
This van has traveled many miles in a short amount of time. This team from the Team Chase Foundation, The Reason.
My ex-Simon.
They are on a mission to spread kindness, surprising strangers with small gestures on a road trip from Falmouth to Atlanta, Georgia, each time handing out a token basketball, explaining the meaning.
It's called the Chase Challenge Kindness Ball, and it's basically to do an act of kindness, pass it on, and to keep that ball rolling.
The challenge is in honor of Chase Soares, son to Brooke and Norman DeBarros, brother to Braden. The 23-year-old basketball all-star died in a car crash in Bourne in February of 2020.
It was the worst thing that I have ever been through in my life. My biggest fear was that people were going to forget about my son.
Brooke spent months grieving and thinking of ways to honor Chase. Basketball, his passion, had to be a part of it.
I have some great memories out here with him playing basketball. At 12, I could get him. At 13, and I said, well, I know at 15, it's going to be over for me. And at 15, he went by me, and that was a wrap.
Mom never missed a game. He was very good, but he didn't act like it.
After the accident, friends shared endless stories of how generous Chase had been with them.
He would make every friend of his think that they were his best friend.
I just wanted something that I could do on a daily basis to spread Chase's kindness.
The foundation and the challenge launched on Chase's birthday. He was born in Atlanta, so that was the first destination. Board member Alicia Fry and Braden on the adventure with Brooke.
I had watched Brooke go through the hardest time of her life, and I knew it would help her in her healing.
On the way home, as part of an effort to spread awareness far and wide, they joined the crowd outside ABC News in New York.
No, it's just an amazing experience to see Robin and Good Morning America.
The kindness balls have a QR code on the back. If you scan it, you can register your act of kindness and see where that ball has traveled. They are on the move.
And the ball keeps on rolling because it's going to all different states.
It pretty much resonates with every soul and human being. Everybody feels better when they're giving of themselves.
Such a touching way to honor their son. We'll bring you more inspiring journeys after the break. Welcome back. We're now taking you to the best kind of adventures for kids, field trips. WVTM reporter Maddie Davis shows us how kids are hitting the water to learn some life skills in Alabama.
A canoe ride on a beautiful day. For these adaptive learners, it's a new kind of experience, not only getting them out in nature to be active, but also teaching motor, social, and behavioral skills.
All right, here we go.
The Jefferson County Schools Department of Exceptional Education providing a meaningful learning experience.
Canoeing is one of the most sensory activities out there.
The calm of the water.
Safe, relaxing, calm.
Putting students at ease.
Get away from some technology.
And helping to develop life skills.
We're working on behavior, waiting our turns, meeting people, working with people they've never been around.
A day outdoors with teachers and peers, players from Garden Dell's football team devoting their time to show they care.
They make me feel safe, they make me feel like I'm somebody.
But the players themselves leaving the park with a new perspective.
Being less fortunate than us, they just come out here and just enjoy life and just, you know, take nothing for granted. And that's something that I want to continue to carry on through my life.
As they take their final lap out in the water and bring the canoes back into shore, these students, teachers, and volunteers will go home with memories that last forever.
What a beautiful trip with memories to last a lifetime, I'm sure. In Massachusetts, WCVB reporter Doug Meehan introduces us to some fourth graders who traded in the classroom for the ice rink.
Welcoming fist bumps, we're met with perhaps a few nervous butterflies for these fourth graders from Burncoat Elementary. Because for some, entering the Fidelity Bank Worcester Ice Center is the first time ever inside an ice rink. Never mind being suited up in helmets and hockey skates.
We always say community first.
Mike Myers is COO of the Worcester Railers Hockey Club, the New York Islanders minor league team playing host for their annual Skate to Success community outreach program.
We chose fourth graders because it's an adventurous age and curious minds, and it's been extremely successful and well-received.
There you go, brand new jersey.
Once all geared up, these rookies taking to the ice in their own time and stride. For some, a reassuring rail was a good first step. For others, a guiding hand and an encouraging word, helping lead the way to bucket loads of frozen fun.
First time on ice ever?
Yeah.
What do you think?
It's really good. I'm having fun.
It's kind of scary, but fun.
Scary but fun? What's the best part about it?
That I get to skate on ice.
Even though this may be the first time out on the ice for some of these kids, it's not the first time they've heard of the program. In fact, it's something that they look forward to going into fourth grade.
It's so slippery, and you might fall.
But that's okay, right?
Yeah, you'll have fun. You'll learn.
And that's the bottom line when you sometimes end up on your bottom. Learning to love something new, part of the purpose of Skate to Success. Another goal, as my friend Cedric shared with me, overcoming your fears can lead to you feeling confident and brave.
First thing I did was fall straight away. But then I had this hurt in my heart, said, just try it.
And here you are going for it.
Yeah.
Teaching us that even if you fall, you can get right back up again. Now also in the Boston area, WCVB reporter Erica Tarantell brings us a field trip that has changed lives.
Wow.
trading bus for ferry, leaving the city behind for a day. Seventh grade students arrive to a warm hello on Thompson Island. It's a middle school tradition for Thompson Island Outward Bound to invite Boston Public School kids to connect with this new environment, learn STEM skills, and explore.
Are we ready to have some fun today? Yeah!
Jason Bastine, now in charge, remembers his first trip here in the seventh grade. He came reluctantly, but the visit changed his life.
So the option was I was even going to get suspended from school for the 3 days, or I can come here on Thompson Island for those 3 days. I spent that third day on Thompson Island crying after dark because I didn't want to leave. And a big part of it is because I knew what I had to return to. I knew I was in a place where people were asking me if they what I needed and that they cared for me. And not to say I didn't get that, but it was just so natural here.
At the dock, he was told he could return in high school with a program called Green Ambassadors, but he'd have to apply to get in.
I went from having all D's and F's to getting A's and B's the very next semester.
Green Ambassadors is a paid internship program for Boston teens. The ambassadors learn natural resource management and take part in team building activities. One goal is to foster environmental stewardship.
An attachment to the natural world and concern for ecology and the environment.
Another desired outcome?
To equip our students for post-secondary education, for careers, for life, for financial independence in adulthood.
Sometimes there are surprises as things get seated.
Checking on an island aquaponic system is former Green Ambassador, now crew leader, Katiana Pires.
I feel like it's just like changed me as a person, because like back in the city, there's just like so much going on. And the more you're like here, it's like escape. But it's very therapeutic for me. Just on island.
So invasive species, they harm our native plants.
Jason ended up majoring in environmental studies at Boston College. After graduating, he decided to return here too, hoping to engage and inspire the next generation.
I could help other people show them like, hey, you're next. Help us take control. Whatever the students need, that's what I'm here to do.
What a great way to pass kindness forward. We hope these adventures inspire you to go out and discover something new. I'm Stephen Graves from all of us here at Stitch. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.